Members, this is the session on security. I welcome the Secretary, Mr. John Lee, and Undersecretary, Mr. Sunny Ao, and Permanent Secretary, Mrs. Marion Lai, as well as their team. I will first ask the Secretary to make an opening remark, and then members will ask questions. Members, please press the request to speak button if you would like to ask any questions. Please keep your speech to within 5 minutes. Chairman, in the draft estimate for the new financial year, allocation for the two policy areas under Security Bureau's responsibility will account for $48.9 billion, representing 8% of total government expenditure. On law and order, the major operational targets of the Hong Kong Police Force for 2019 are to combat violent crimes, triads, syndicated and organized crimes, dangerous drugs and quick cash crimes, to promote cybersecurity and combat technology crimes, and to ensure public security, public safety, and step up counter-terrorism work. There will be an additional 179 additional posts created in the police force in 2019-20. These are mainly for increasing manpower support for the Hong Kong Johor Macau Bridge, strengthening police force capability in tackling trafficking in persons and protecting foreign domestic helpers, and enhancing Hong Kong's capabilities in anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist financing, etc. The West Kowloon Terminal of the XRL and the Hong Kong Johor Macau Bridge were commissioned in September and October last year. Hung Yun Wai Boundary Control Point is expected to come into operation in 2019-20. The frontline law enforcement departments will get prepared to ensure smooth operation of the new control point. Since the commencement of the comprehensive review of the strategy of handling non-refoulement claims in early 2016, various measures have yielded considerable results. The numbers of illegal immigrants and non-refoulement claims have dropped significantly by 80% from the peak. The Immigration Department has basically completed the screening of the backlog of over 10,000 claims. Although there are still some 6,000 appeal pending handling by the Torture Claims Appeal Board, we expect the number to drop gradually within, and their handling will be completed in 2 years. The government will continue with various suitable measures, including the submission of an amendment bill to improve the screening procedure, and we will ensure that sufficient resources are available to handle the claims and appeals efficiently and fairly. We will also put in more effort to expedite the removal of rejected claimants from Hong Kong. In relation to combating trafficking in persons, in March last year, the government established a high-level inter-bureau departmental steering committee to combat trafficking in persons. It is chaired by the CS4A. An action plan with 40 new measures was promulgated. The Hong Kong Police Force, Immigration Department, CNE Department, Labour Department and Department of Justice will create a total of 90 posts to fully and vigorously implement the measures promulgated in the action plan. In relation to the territory-wide identity card replacement exercise, the exercise started in 2018. The Immigration Department will continue to replace existing smart Hong Kong ID cards of all holders in phases at the 9 smart identity card replacement centres. The Fire Services Department will have 135 new posts in the new financial year, mainly for increasing ambulance shift, serving as ambulance hospital controllers, operating the railroad fire appliance procured for firefighting and rescue operations in railway conduits and tunnels, as well as strengthening the department's capability in handling maritime incidents and supporting high-angle rescue operations. Last year, the government worked with the URA, the Urban Renewal Authority, to launch the Fire Safety Improvement Work Subsidy Scheme. We have received over 2,500 applications. Successful applicants were notified gradually, and there will be assigned case officers who will provide appropriate assistance and follow-up. We hope that this subsidy scheme, together with a series of Improvised measures promoted by the Fire Services Department could facilitate owners of old composite buildings to carry out improvement works as soon as possible in order to comply with the fire safety requirements under the Fire Safety Buildings Ordinance. The CSD Correctional Services Department is committed to improving correctional facilities, including installing electric locks systems in Stanley Prison, Tai Lam Centre for Women and Pickok Correctional Institution, and replacing and enhancing the closed-circuit television systems in 11 correctional facilities, including Stanley Prison, Pickok Prison and Hailing Chow Correctional Institution, etc. The CSD will develop smart prison for the sustainable development of correctional system using innovation and technology, including piloting the health signs monitoring system, video analytic monitoring system and passage surveillance system to modernize correctional facilities with a view to enhancing the efficiency of prison management and level of security. The CSD will provide diversified and market-oriented vocational training to persons in custody, having regard to the overall situation and demand of the employment market, with a view to enhancing the ability to be reintegrated into society. I myself and my representatives will be happy to answer questions. There are 16 members who have pressed the request to speak button. I will read out their names. Claudia Mo, Alvin Young, Charles Mok, Gary Fan, Leung Chee Chung, Priscilla Leung, Pun Siu Ping, Christopher Jung, Chang Chung Tai, Fernando Jung, Tony Tse, Helena Wong, Elizabeth Kwot, Ray Chen, Mr. Lam Chak Ting, and Xiu Ka Chun, Ms. Claudia Mo. I would like to very quickly ask, because the secretary said that, one of the major operational targets is to promote cybersecurity, but the government has been abusing the offense of dishonest use of computers. The court has already given a judgment. Well, previously you have frightened netizens by using indiscriminately this offense. What are you going to do now? And I now want to ask about question 23, the one-way permit. Well, I think it's ridiculous that you ask the question and they give you a completely different answer. They said that they would exchange views with mainland authorities on a one-way permit. I asked you, how are these exchanges done? How many times have you met them? What is the cost involved? And whether you would, by phases, take back the decision-making of one-way permit applications back to Hong Kong. And you have given us a totally different answer. Well, as we all know that regarding family reunion, of course, we won't oppose to that. But now they can use any reason. And it's rumored that every day about 30 to 40 Communist Party members using different reasons to come to Hong Kong. It seems that you have turned a deaf ear to people's demand. It is very irresponsible. Secretary, in relation to cybersecurity, well, as we're all aware of the judgment of the CFA in relation to Section 161. The DOJ will take that into account and consider how to proceed in the future. There are three offenses to deal with general cases like this. Say, for example, loitering, disorderly in public places. Well, if it is a case that disrupts public law and order, the DOJ would consider taking action. I think that, is it the case that these three offences you have just named covered acts like Peeping Tom? I myself and the DOJ agree that legislative work is required. That is a very clear stance. We are anxious as well. We understand that the Law Reform Commission has made a proposal about peeping. We would conduct consultation and we will actively pursue the line of a legislative amendment. In relation to one-way permit, we have had numerous discussions here. I understand that there are different views, but we have to act in accordance with the basic law. In a motion debate in the LegCo, I have explained that we have communicated with them, and as a result of our communications, there are adjustments and changes to the arrangements. Ms. Mo, you would like to supplement? Please turn on Ms. Mo's microphone. I'm most concerned that you have not reflected Hong Kong people's view on one-way permit to mainland authorities. Mr. Lee, anything to add? We have been exchanging views in our communication. Next, Mr. Alvin Yeung, 4 minutes. I want to ask about 165. It's in relation to the quality of Hong Kong police force. I can see that in 2018 for permanent police officers involved in serious offenses, the number has increased from 2018 about 20 to 30 people. I believe that most police officers are law-abiding and are of high caliber, but I'm very concerned about that, especially when I look at the number of police officers involved in criminal cases. It has increased from 21 to 30. I would like to get an answer. I also see that there is a working group set up in relation to the integrity management of the police force. So I would like to hear from the secretary. I will first speak on the policy level and then I will defer to the commissioner to answer your question. For a disciplined service, whatever it is, there is a very stringent requirement. If an officer commits misconduct, there is a mechanism to deal with such a breach under relevant ordinances. Integrity management is important. I know that the police has done a lot of work in this regard. Let's hear from the commissioner. Mr. Low. Just like Mr. Yeung, I feel sad about such figures. We see from time to time some bad apples in any discipline services all over the world. I would like to say that the police would have no tolerance of such bad apples, which will affect the image of the police. Well, you talk about 30 people. Yes, it is a significant increase compared to 15 people. But 30 people out of about 30,000 officers. So it's just about 0.001%. Over 99% of the police officers are working very hard, but it doesn't mean that we would tolerate that. One case is too many. The working group has started two measures. First is guidelines in relation to misconduct, and two measures to enhance the sense of belonging and loyalty so that the police officers will be mindful of their behavior. Well, if police officers see that there are signs that another officer might have committed misconduct or going that way, we hope that they would render support to them. There is also education, management, punishment, as well as rehabilitation. We have put in these measures for a very long time, and we have seen that they are effective. Sorry for interruption. Are you confident that next year when we come back here, the figure will drop? Do you have faith that it will drop? Well, we would like to identify the reason why someone would break the law. But there are different factors and causes to each different case. We have done some work. If you ask me, of course, I am confident. But would there be new situations arising in the future? I can't tell. But we have the determination and the confidence to get rid of all bad apples in the force. Mr. Charles Mock, I would like to follow up on 148. That is in relation to dishonest access to computer with criminal or dishonest intent. I have been asking about your the different types. This time, again, you told us that you have not kept a breakdown of the information. I've been asking for 5 years. But whether it's peeping, criminal intent mitigation, public order, what is the classification? I want to know how you have abused the offense. You did not admit that it was an abuse, but now the court ruling has made it very clear that it is wrong to keep expanding the scope of this offense. You said that you're very anxious to try to deal with it. In 2015, when I moved a motion, why didn't you say that? Your predecessor said that, we will choose an offense that will get us a conviction more easily. And you have caused a public panic. And the LRC has, many years ago, proposed an offense that deals with peeping. My question is, out of the number of cases that charges are under which charges have been laid, well, apart from taking upskirt photos, you say that there are three offenses that you can use. How are you going to deal with existing cases? Can you change the offense? How many cases will be affected, and what is the number? The CFA has given an ultimate interpretation in relation to the interpretation and application of access to computer with criminal or dishonest intent. We have to ensure that all future prosecutions and law enforcement actions are in accordance with the law. But before the CFA has delivered judgment, I would like to say that it was the court that convicted the defendants. Yes, the CFA has given a clear interpretation of the application of Section 161. Well, according to court ruling, is such an act is conducted with a dishonest intent. No, the court said that you have been expanding the scope of the offense, and that itself is wrong. Please don't blame lower levels of court. And I've been telling you the same thing for many years. Why are you still trying to argue on this point? I would like to know how you're going to deal with existing cases, because you have created the problem yourself. It is the Security Bureau. Well, we a decision was made based on the interpretation of the law at that time. That's what I wanted to say. Well, the LRC proposed a voyeurism offense. From the information I have, the proposal was made in 2018, and they are in the process of collecting public opinions to find out how to implement the proposal. And I have explained that we would like to have the proposals so that we can take actions targeting the action themselves.
個案那裡, 你們想不想補充?
Would you like to supplement on the number of cases affected by this? We don't have any figure. Okay, please provide supplementary information after the meeting. Mr. Gary Fang, 4 minutes, 053, 056, about the trend of admission of tenant schemes. I've asked a number of questions in the past 3 years, among the five, under the five schemes, the total number of people admitted, we've seen an increasing trend, and also an increasing trend for those who have been given right of abode, 2018, more than 10,000. And every year, on average, 50,000 people were approved for extension of stay. So for just 1 year, it will be more than the number of new arrivals under the one-way permit. If this trend continues to rise, the population, the pressure arising from the population increase will be tremendous. How would the administration act as the gatekeeper? He said that this will be done under 2+3+3 or 2+6. In respect of extension of stay. In assessing such application for extension of stay, what criteria would you refer to? And what kind of income level would you require? And how do you make sure that information about the employer is correct? And that the performance is in line with the policy objective for such admission schemes. If the threshold is too low, you create a big loophole for people to falsify things, and then we'll have more and more people admitted into Hong Kong. I asked the CI Bureau the Innovation and Technology Bureau about how checks are carried out. They say they will just rely on the documentation submitted. Secretary for Security, I'll talk about the policy and then the immigration, the direct immigration. We'll talk about the assessment of applications. Well, we know all over the world, we want to attract talent. They had various places have to compete for talent. The general employment policy and various admission schemes for mainland talent, etc. We require a high level of educational attainment, usually a degree holder, or in that particular field, they have special abilities or skills. Whether it's a general admission scheme or admission scheme for talent, the information is open and transparent. You can find the information on the website of Immigration Department. For example, a good educational background. I talk about how you assess and the applications. As I've said, various places compete for this group of talents. If we don't do it, we'll lose out. Director of Immigration. Well, generally speaking, we'll look at the credentials, the degree that he holds, and whether he has skills or expertise, which Hong Kong is lacks. Also look at the salary. If necessary, we can check all the documents and clarify the points to see if there's any falsification. All such process will be handled very strangely. 4 minutes, Dr. Priscilla Leung is a SB020. With regard to the handling of non-refoulement claims and the arrangement to the reduce the backlog, which the administration says has been quite significant in its effect. Under the duty lawyer scheme to handle such claims, there's been some layoff exercises, and I know one or two of them. They are very experienced. They offer very good quality. They were involved right from the very beginning. Earlier this year, the Chief Justice said there were backlogs of claims in the court, and they had to redeploy judges to handle non-refoulement claims. The number is a few hundred to a thousand, so it was a cry for help because of the huge pressure on judicial manpower. You have streamlined the procedure. As you have claimed, you have streamlined the procedure. My concern is that you have reduced the manpower. Are you going to shift the pressure to the judiciary? That's not what we want to see. That's not the way to handle the backlog of claims. We attach importance to quality of work. At one point, I suggested that you should approach more law firms to handle such cases, such claims professionally. You must have some people, some department in charge of this. And now you have been laying off people. Have you resolved the problems? Will the new cases be handled by inexperienced people? And then those would turn into judicial review cases. Because JR case usually are about the due process and whether the procedures are properly carried out. Dr. Leung, I think we should differentiate two things. First, what we do within the government structure to handle such claims. First, the Immigration Department will assess the case, and then it was judged to be substantiated or not. And then we have the appeal board at the appeal. Board will come to a ruling as to whether the claim is substantiated or not. So that's the existing mechanism, existing arrangement. For those who fail in the claims, they should be repatriated. But anyone in Hong Kong can lodge an application for judicial review. Then that's part of the legal proceedings. Just like anybody else who would like to challenge the action taken by the government. So we are talking about two different things. We are not passing our application vetting and assessment work to the courts. I understand that. You have cancelled an entire working unit where we find the most experienced people. You have reduced the secretariat staff and the staff for handling such cases. So the question is about the laying off of experienced people. Well, actually, the cases to be handled by the duty lawyer scheme depends on the actual workload. And at peak periods, we need to handle 8,000 cases, and we need more. And now with the efforts expended by our staff in the immigration department, we don't have so many cases. So the caseload has reduced, and therefore the demand for service has come down, and we don't need so many people to handle those cases. We have expedited the application, and therefore there are fewer cases to handle, and therefore the demand for DLS service has come down, and we'll inform the service provider under DLS on the likely number of cases that they need to handle. That's what we have been doing under our current arrangement. Quality will be assured because we'll be using the same group of lawyers. All the lawyers are there. It's just that the number of cases that they need to handle will be lower. As a result, the number of lawyers involved will be lower. All these lawyers have been trained and experienced. Mr. Pun Xiuping, 4 minutes. I want to ask my question, the 35079. It's about the 7 emission scheme. The reply is that up to February 2019, 6,500 or so people have been admitted. You have 8 categories, and one of them is others. 37,000 people admitted under that category. Another category involves 10,500. And what about the breakdown for the other categories? So that we know what economic sectors these people belong to. 10,000 or more people earn under $20,000. Well, which industry or trades are they in? You mentioned the people with doctorate, a master degree, or bachelor degree, and others at 17,000. So what qualification, education qualification do they have? And also for the admission of mainland talent, we have 13,000 people admitted under this scheme. And under the category of others, 2,300 or so. Do we have further breakdowns for this from the Immigration Department? And under the admission scheme, we have a category for artistic and cultural sector. On what basis are these people assessed to be suitable for admission? And we have a talent admission scheme. Of course, we are not against the admission of talent by the government. We have 430 who came before February 2019, and 130 admitted under the category of others. Of course, there are 5 different sectors under this scheme, including recreation and sports. So I'd like to get more breakdowns. And also I want to ask a question about the establishment of immigration staff. From in the year 2018-2019, you've added 6 staff for the admission scheme for mainland talents and professionals, and for the non-local graduates, you add 6 for innovation and technology, 3. So altogether, you increase the establishment by 15 staff. The number of people admitted under the admission scheme for mainland talents and professionals has not increased significantly. Why do you need to add so many people to the working teams? Are you expecting that there will be a lot of people coming forward to apply?
There is a large group of questions. I will defer to the Director for Immigration, Mr. Zhang. So in relation to the different classification of the types, so we have set out the major types of jobs, and there are still some minor ones, but we don't want to make the answer too complicated, that's why we have not included them in the breakdown, but we will give you the information after the meeting for your reference. Regarding our establishment on visa management, yes, there was a time where with an increased workload, it wasn't matched by an increased level of manpower. We have also enhanced our inspection on visa, so we would have more manpower to deal with the additional work. Thank you. Well, perhaps you will give us the information in supplementary information. Next, Mr. Christopher Zhang, 4 minutes. I would like to ask about 192 in relation to the cross-boundary movement of physical currency and bearer negotiable instruments ordinance. Well, between July and last year and February this year, there has been over 14,000 declarations in relation to currency. It's about $164 billion. On average, it's $11 million per declaration. In relation to goods, 6,490 involving $830 billion. On average, is the amount declared is $11 million. Is that normal? Will the Secretary provide additional information to us? What are these cash items? Are they mostly hard cash, securities, or shares or instruments? Are they from the mainland or from other parts of the world? Compared to other international cities, are we on the high side or not? When the CNE department received the declarations, and when they are aware that the declaration is up to $11 million, will they ask the traveler for the reasons for such a large amount? I would defer to the director for customs and excise. About the implementation of the cross-boundary movement of physical currency and bearer negotiable instruments ordinance, there are over 10,000 visitors involving over $190 billion. We see that on average, it's about $120,000 to maybe a billion or so. Over 90% of the declarations were made by financial institutions. And we will vet every application very carefully. Where there is any doubt, we would conduct in-depth investigation. So far, we have not identified any cases that require further action. The member asked about comparison. We haven't done such a comparison yet. And we can't tell you that whether we're on the high side or the low side. Anything to say to in your follow-up, Mr. Zhang? Did you ask visitors why they would bring such a large amount of with them instead of using electronic means? Well, of course, visitors will bring cash for their own reasons. What we care about is whether such an act contravenes the law. If necessary, we will follow up and conduct investigation. Chen Chong Tai. I would like to ask about 130, 1858 and 164. They are in relation to the police force. There was an incident last year. A married superintendent went with a married woman to a safe house to do hanky-panky things. Well, that's a euphemism. I have questions to ask. About the married superintendent, has he breached any code or regulations? Well, we have the right to ask about the number, locations of safe house and the cost involved. And in the past 3 years, how many police officers have wrongly used safe houses? However, for the three questions, you gave us the same answer. You said that, well, it involves secret operations of the police. So when it comes to monitoring, use, operation, arrangements, they don't have to give us an answer. If you say that there is a vigorous mechanism in place, why would what I've said has happened? And people are concerned. I think there may be a suspected case of misconduct in public office. Has that person been penalized? Did he have to go through any disciplinary hearing? Any information that you can give us? Well, after this case of abuse of safe houses, have you put in place any measures to prevent future reoccurrence of such an incident? I will first give you some general answer and then I will defer to the Commissioner for Police. I understand that members have asked, well, they have been asking about details on rewards and special services. We have a vigorous mechanism in place to ensure proper use of such resources. Apart from the internal audit of the police, senior officers of the Audit Commission will also conduct a separate and independent audit on the breakdown to make sure that we have made proper use of the funds. Of course, the police will have to strictly follow rules and to deal with disciplinary cases. Mr. Low, the case is still under investigation, so we will not make any comments. The police attach a lot of importance on the conduct and integrity of police officers. If it is found after investigation that there is any misconduct, there is any breach of any regulations and the law, we will follow it up very seriously. Well, sensitive information as well as a secret operation information is involved. That's why I can't give you an answer. I don't think you will carry out an investigation into whether it is an extramarital affair. I just want to ask. Well, I ask about reasons about, in general, where is the location of the safe house and how can that superintendent know when to use it and know the password? Commissioner, well, if there is any breach, we will seriously follow it up. Next, Dr. Fernando Zhou. I would like to ask a number of questions. First, I would like to ask about question number 4. The replacement of for smart ID card. In the replacement exercise, a person is allowed to bring with them, two elderly people to deal with the replacement. I think it's a very good arrangement because elderly people can be accompanied and they don't have to go back and twice. But it, under the this arrangement, people with disabilities are not allowed to be brought along. There are people who suffer from autism or intellectual disability. If you require them to go and apply for a replacement of the ID card, it will be very difficult. So I'd like to ask the Immigration Department, can they extend this arrangement to people with disability? That means someone can bring them along for the replacement. Let's hear from Mr. Zhang, the director.
We have make some arrangement under the new ID application system, some caring arrangements, including allowing two elderly members of the family of the applicant to go at the same time. And we also make arrangement for services to be provided to elderly homes and homes for the disabled. As regards, we can extend this to other people in need. We would seriously consider this, having regard to our resources and other factors. We certainly try to improve our service. We would consider this in due course. I hope you can do this. You can extend the service to the disabled as soon as you can. I want to ask some questions about SB 185 and 190, and that is the wages paid to those inmates. On average, they will be paid $500 to $600. For those who are about to be discharged, they will only have a few hundred dollars in their pocket. So rehabilitation will be difficult, especially for those who have no family members outside to help them. And under SB 190, you talk about 40 full-time and part-time vocational training courses in 2019, but you do not mention the number of inmates in participating in those courses. How many people can you take on? And how many are under 20 years old? How can you promote this and allow more inmates to be admitted to such training courses? And Mr. Wu, Commissioner of Correctional Services, well, actually, since the inmates are provided with all the daily necessities, so the money they earn can be used for buying snacks or for savings, so that they can use the money when they are discharged. If they need help, we would liaise with other government departments to provide assistance, including accommodation and the financial assistance in the initial stage of discharge. On the number of places, we have 1,400 annually. In line with our past experience, the number would be sufficient. But if there's a sudden increase, we can make adjustments accordingly. As for the places for youth training, all young inmates would receive education for half the day and vocational training for the other half. So all young offenders, young inmates are receiving vocational training. Mr. Tony Chan, I want to follow up some questions about SB 139. Number of prosecutions and arrests in respect of protests or public assemblies. It seems that in the past 3 years, the number has stabilized. It's about 12 to 13,000 a year for those which the police was not informed, and then the number of people arrested or prosecuted has declined significantly, which is good. The police arrested more than 1,000 people for the illegal Occupy Central movement, and then you make appointments with 48 of the organizers. 9 of them have now been prosecuted. It's almost 5 years since the occupation movement, Occupy Central movement. What are you going to do with the rest? I'm not saying that you must press prosecution, because it's been 4 or 5 years now that if you drag your feet like that, it may not be fair to those people. I know this may have to do with the Department of Justice, but can the police and the Security Bureau update us on the progress? Have you done all that is required of you, and now you are awaiting the reply from the Department of Justice for further action? I would first of all respond by describing the general picture. During the 2014 Occupation Central Movement, 995 people were arrested by the police as who were suspected of committing various offences. 48 people were arrested after the movement. 225 people have been or are under some legal procedures. 169 people have completed the relevant procedures. 127 convicted, 427 bound over. And what are the offences involved? Illegal assembly, possession of offensive weapons, criminal damage, assaulting police officers, rape, possession of dangerous drugs, and public nuisance. The case for which the judgment has just been delivered. I'll leave further details to the commissioner. Mr. Stephen Lo, Commissioner of Police. We are maintaining close communication with the Department of Justice, and we are taking the necessary investigation. If we have sufficient evidence, we will take further action. Mr. Chair? Chairman, of course, I hope that they can make decisions as soon as possible, because if this drags on, it may not be fair to those affected. I want to ask some questions about 59 and 67, about the number of people coming to Hong Kong through various boundary checkpoints, especially the West Kowloon station of the high-speed rail and Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge boundary crossing facilities. The numbers have now stabilized. Do you have sufficient manpower? Or are you over provided with manpower because of the high expected turnout in the initial stage, where operations are smooth generally, but there are peak periods when the police, the immigration, and the custom excise department have to do some temporary redeployment? We have considered all these factors in come up with the manpower provision. We think the current levels of manpower are appropriate. Dr. Helena Wong, SB 159.
It's a question from Mr. Paul Chair. It's about prostitution and vice establishment. I used to be a member of the IPCC. I'm grateful that at that point, at that time, the police arranged for members of IPCC to the witness some race to vice establishments in Wong Kong. According to the criminal offense ordinance, the penalty is 7 years for the managing a vice establishment. How many vice establishments do we have in Hong Kong? Secretary, Commissioner? We don't have any statistic on the number of vice establishment in Hong Kong. If you don't have that, how do you organize your race? Do you just count on your luck? Well, we would act on complaints from the public. So you don't know where they are and or the number of vice establishment. We don't count them. Well, that's strange. We have been given the number of arrests, but you don't know where they are or which is a vice establishment. And so you only know when there's a complaint, right? According to the offense, the landlord or the tenant, if they suffer a vice establishment to be operated there, then you can prosecute them. How many successful prosecution have there been in the past 3 years? Did you prosecute the landlord or the tenant? And what's the average prison term meted out? If you ask me how many vice establishments are in the entire of Hong in the entire Hong Kong, we don't have figures, but we have intelligence. We do our analysis. We also receive complaints. We take action when we suspect that some premises are vice establishments. So we do have the number of arrests. As for allowing or the letting premises used as vice establishment, we don't have a breakdown of figures. How many, do you have any statistics on the number of prosecutions? The maximum penalty is 7 years imprisonment. If you talk about past years, of course we can find the figures. Please provide it afterwards. If the premises are judged to be for vice establishment, then the police can apply for closure order under cap 153A. The closure order will be valid for 6 months. What is the limitation period? And would you conduct the raid to the same establishment again before the end of the closure period, or the relevant limitation period? If you don't, you will never be able to apply for a closure order. If you are not doing this, would you consider amending cap 135A? That is to say that to do away with the requirement of a repeated offense of letting and premises to be used as vice establishment. Well, that is after the conviction, from the 4th to the 16th, within that year after conviction, if we say that we conduct another raid, and we can apply for a closure order. But we don't keep statistics. Dr. Wong has asked for some supplementary information. Mr. Lo, please note that. We don't have the breakdown figures in our computer system, but I'll do what I can do. I'll see what I can do. Dr. Elizabeth Kuo, I want to talk about sneak photo taking. There was a case, the accused was charged with obtaining access to computer with a dishonest intent. The charge was dropped, and the accused was bound over. There's no criminal record registered against him. It seems that the people feel that there's a vacuum, and no one can. That's the suggestion of a new charge of voyeurism. But if we legislate for this new offense, it would take some time. So in the meantime, how are you going to take action against of offenders of this nature in private premises?
I would like to ask about the abuse of non-refoulement claimant. Claim. I know that the administration has done a lot of work. We see the backlog has dropped. They are now asking for appeals and judicial review. So still, there is an outstanding number of cases of about $10,000. In the past few years, they have used about a lot of money. When will you deal with these outstanding 10,000 cases? And from the information from reply number 5, I see that every year there are about 1,000 cases of non-refoulement claims involved in criminal cases. In 2018, number of cases has dropped. However, there is an increase regarding dangerous drugs. How are you going to curb this trend? In relation to the CFA's judgment on access to computer with criminal or dishonest intent, as I've said that if it's a public place, there'll be loitering or public order disturbance, misconduct in a public place. But if it is outside a public place, there may be a case of a breach of the peace. We can still take the culprit to court. We will definitely proceed with the legislative exercise. Of course, each case is different, and it will be dealt with according to the facts of the case. The police and the DOJ will find the right offense to apply. Regarding non-refoulement claimants, I'm sure that Ms. Court is very familiar with the entire process. The Immigration Department has been working very hard to reduce the number of backlog. They have practically cleared the backlog. The next step is for the Torture Claim Appeals Board to do their work. Over 2 or 3 years, they will be able to clear the backlog. Afterwards, in theory, we'll be able to repatriate the people involved. However, if a judicial review is applied for, then we'll have to leave it to the court. As far as I know, there are about 3,000 or so people who have applied for judicial review. The court is looking into how to deal with such a large amount of cases. Of course, we have to respect an independent judiciary. What the government can do is to deal with the case to see if it is substantiated or not, and then deal with the appeal so as to repatriate them. The government has done a lot of work. The appeals board and the immigration department have been working very hard. What remains will be for the court to deal with. Ms. Court, you would like to add, what about drugs-related cases? There is an increasing trend. I'll defer to the commissioner. Mr. Low, please be brief. Thank you. Non-refoulement claimant, that means Form 8 holders. There was a sharp drop in 2018, a drop from 1,150 cases by 392 people, 25% regarding dangerous drugs, an increase of 3.5% by 7 people. Actually, the situation regarding Form 8 holders, it has greatly improved. We will monitor these cases. The actions will be under the leadership of the OCTB, the Organized Crime and Trial Bureau. I would like to follow up on 36 and 37. And in 36, I asked if there is any guideline with the Immigration Department for the frontline officers in relation to cases involving transsexual persons. What assistance would be given to transsexual persons or people of sexual minority, and if there is any training given to officers? The government said that everyone is treated equally. And they said that there will be training in relation to anti-discrimination, etc. But there is no sensitivity training. It's not a problem of treating everyone equally. Law enforcement officers may have very low sensitivity when dealing with them. There may be communications problems which may give rise to conflicts when they deal with people of sexual minority. We have spent some time to come up with guidelines for medical officers. Later it will be expanded to teachers. However, there is nothing for law enforcement officers. Say, for example, I mentioned Immigration Department here because a transsexual person may not be able to change the gender on their identity documents even after they've gone through the sex reassignment surgery. They told us that the Immigration Department may detain them or may make things difficult for them or will treat them quite harshly. I don't blame frontline officers. There are some cases involving police officers. I won't use the word discrimination. It's a lack of understanding. They thought that even the evidence it's toxic, and they would write down it belongs to a fag, stuff like that. I think that you need to give it further consideration. It's training to enhance the sensitivity and understanding towards a sexual minority should be given, because this will be conducive to reducing conflicts. Please listen to me. In relation to reply number 37 is about the XRL. It was commissioned in September. The Hong Kong Drama coverage was commissioned in October. Over just 2 or 3 months, number of rejected cases with documents not in order for XRL is 660. For Lowu, which is the busiest control point, over the year is less than 600 cases. Did you think about why? Is it something to do with co-location? Because under the conventional approach, people will have their documents checked at the starting point and they will be turned away if the documents are not in order. But now you wait for them to arrive here before you check their documents. Maybe that is the reason why we have 600 cases or so. So number 35 is for comments and 36 is a question. I will say something about sexual minorities. I thank Mr. Chen for the comments, and I will forward the comment to different departments for their consideration. The second part I will defer to the director, Mr. Zhang, about the number of rejection cases. From the figure alone, most of them are in cases of improperly documented people. But there is no further breakdown whether it's there is no visa or the travel documents. This is a new control point. When visitors come to Hong Kong, they may not be aware of visa requirements. we will enhance our publicity so that visitors will have a better understanding of our requirements. Mr. Chen, you do need to conduct an analysis. This is not about being new or old. You come via Lo Wu or via the XRL station or Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. There's no direct correlation with documentation preparation. For the XRL, 3 months, 600 cases. Lo Wu, a year, less than 600. You do need to look into it. Thank you. Next, Mr. Lam Chek Ting, 4 minutes. I would like to follow up on 61. Regrettably, the administration did not answer my question directly. Well, for individual visit endorsement, that is G endorsement, it covers 49 cities, including Shenzhen. There are different types, once every 3 months, once every 3 months, 4 times a year or 1 time a year. I asked the administration whether there is any restriction on the number of applications under the individual visit endorsement. However, the administration did not give me an answer. I will answer for you. Yes, you can make multiple applications. I have got confirmation from frontline officers of the department as well as visitors themselves. Well, for those with individual visit endorsement, even when they live in Shenzhen, they don't have to apply for the 1 week visit per week endorsement. They can, under the individual visit endorsement, when they go back, they will make another application. So it's not subject to restriction of once every 3 months or 3 times every 3 months. That means the situation is happening under the nose of immigration officers. That means these people can come to Hong Kong 4 or 5 times a day just to engage in parallel goods trading under the individual visit endorsement. You said that, well, 1 trip per week is conducive to controlling the number of visitors coming to Hong Kong, but the fact is that people living in the 49 cities don't have to follow this. Well, if you live in Shenzhen, it's even more relaxed. So will you talk to mainland authorities to tell them the policy intent? Once every 3 months means once every 3 months and not endless times over 3 months or endless times over a year. Secretary, I will first tell you about my understanding and then we'll see if the director has anything to add. The two policies are different. I understand that Mr. Lam fully understand that there is a difference. Of course, we'll try to find out if what Mr. Lam said has indeed happened. But the individual visit scheme and the 1 trip a week endorsement for Shenzhen residents are two completely different policies. But they are all tourism policies. How are they different? How are they different in nature? One is an individual visit scheme policy, the other one is 1 trip per week. But for 1 trip per week, it's done on an individual basis, not in a group. So tell us, in reality, do they come to Hong Kong many times a day? Mr. Zhang, my understanding is that for once a month or once every 3 months, it's about the validity of the period of the validity period of the visa once over 3 months. But after that, they can make another application to come again. Well, $20 yuan, you can use your Octopus card to make payment at the just before the control point. Will you forward our view to mainland authorities? Well, this is about mainland arrangements. That is, after they've used the visa, how long do they have to wait for another application? We will try to talk to them. If it is a problem, we will reflect our views. Next, Mr. Xu Kaochun, 4 minutes. Thank you. I would like to follow up on 182 and 188. For 182 is asked by Mr. Ao Nok Hin, is in relation to prison schemes. So there are two of them. And according to the administration, they say that for the release under supervision scheme and pre-release employment scheme, there has been a drop. For 2015-16, number of cases was 41 cases to just about 20 cases in 2018-19. How come there is a drop in the number of applications? Well, does the community, does the steering committee, the committee on the community support for rehabilitated offenders, have they done any assessment or analysis to find out why?
My second question is that when ex-offenders want to get jobs, it's very difficult. Would the committee, or has the Committee on Community Support for Rehabilitated Offenders done something to help them so that more the employers will know about the pre-release scheme for offenders? And I also ask a question, a follow-up question to the one raised by Dr. Elizabeth Kwok, that is smart prison. You want to use IT to help you manage prisons and correctional institutions. So apart from managing the inmates, would you also be doing the same in respect of your officers? Because they are bound to be black sheet. Would the smart prison scheme be applied to the management of your officers, including the, those who abuse their powers? And also the video analytic monitoring system, what's the scope of the monitoring, and what's the risk of unauthorized release of the videos, because that has happened previously. And also what's the mental impact on the inmates? I'm not talking about whether the system or the camera are working properly or not, but on the mentality and physical and mental stress imposed on inmates. Let me talk about the release under supervision scheme. There's a dedicated committee to handle such cases. The reports on the applicants are compiled by my department. And why was the success rate recently rather low? Well, each case is different. I cannot really answer the question on the on behalf of the committee. As regarding Committee on Community Support for Rehabilitated Offenders, well, the committee would give us advice on how to improve the employment scheme. The member talked about the difficulty in getting jobs of rehabilitated offenders. The Committee on Community Support for Rehabilitated Offenders have been giving us advice on how to talk to the how to communicate with the employers. We have some 700 employers, compassionate employers, who are offering more than 2,000 job openings to these offenders. If necessary, we offer also further assistance. Smart prison, please be succinct. On the question of using smart prison system to prevent abuse of power, well, with or without the system, we always attach importance to the integrity of our staff. If there are problems, we will deal with them very seriously. As regards the
keeping of video recordings in under the smart prison system. Well, we would keep those videos for 31 days, and there's a very serious restriction on who can view those videos, and we would also have review processes to ensure that the system is complied with. As for the mental impact on inmates arising from the smart prison, we would review the processes carefully, and regular reviews will be conducted. SB 182, which is a question raised by Mr. Xiu Ka-chun. I hope that the department would come up with look at the whether there are objective criteria for under the pre-release employment scheme. If there are no objective criteria, then people don't know what to do. I've been told recently that whether the family members regularly visit the offender would be a factor to consider, because sometimes the inmate would tell their families not to come. And sometimes the date of commencement employment would be important. But I know in some cases the rehabilitated offender or discharged offenders will only be able to report duty after 2 months of the after the discharge. And also we know that the discrepancies of terms of conditional employment among the discipline forces is very big. I've learned from some CSD officers that their quarters have water seepage problems. And we know that 70% for the police and 80% for the FSD officers eligible for quarters are getting them. It said that there's a committee to carry out reviews, and also we different ranks in the police and the fire services department. Well, I think when things become more extreme, that there will be disputes. Mr. Low, the Commissioner of Police, you know that in the Western District, the quarters site is very valuable piece of land. You have been giving the quarters, and now you also want to redevelop the old quarters. You have submitted an application to the Town Planning Board. Can you not heed the advice of the Central Western District Council, because 80% of the eligible officers are already living in quarters? SB 101. The number of prosecutions because of public assemblies and protests. 273 in 2014, and then it drops to 71, 95, 32, and 8 in successive years, because the people are now afraid to come to take to the street. Well, the maximum penalty can be as high as 7 years. You have hired so many officers, you have purchased a water cannon, $27 million, and a pepper spray devices. And last question is again for the Commissioner of Police. If I Well, if I weren't a legal member, it was very difficult to negotiate with the police on the route to be used by protesters. Sometimes we agree with something with the police officer that we saw, but then they would overturn the agreement in the next moment. Secretary, on quarters, in the 2014 policy address, we announced 8 quarters projects for different disciplined services. Of course, there's always a gap between the number of officers eligible and the number of quarters. We have all the 8 projects approved, and one has been completed, and population intake is now happening. Another is about to be completed. We want the departments to make use of land under the department itself for quarters as far as possible. Regarding the questions on the police, I will defer to the commissioner. With regard to the Western District quarter site, I understand the district does have some needs for the land, but our officers have been asking for more quarters to be built. You mentioned the allocation ratio is 79% for 2019-2020, but it was only 73% in the previous year. We're not trying to compete with land in the we're not competing for land with other people in the district. But anyway, wherever we identify a site, there will always be a competing need. And this site is next to the Western District Police Station. So because of security reasons, we cannot provide community facilities in the future quarters. On the question of the route of to be used for protesters, and of course, the organizers may want to have a more visible route so that more people will know about the protest, but we have to balance the community needs. We have provided training to our people. We have a dedicated team to liaise with protest organizers. As for the increase in establishment, 179 officers will be added to the establishment. None of them will be dedicated to the handling of protests and public assemblies. Mr. Jeremy Tam, if there's no other member who would like to raise further questions, then I'll just draw the line here. 179. I'm talking about advanced medical instruction given by the terminally ill. The policy address in 2018 announced that they would be allowed to make the decision on what they want to do when they are terminally ill. When the ambulance arrives, the ambulance man would do the CPR, because the ambulance does not know that their advance instructions have been made. So the resuscitation would be carried out until the time the patient arrives at the hospital, and then you may have successfully resuscitated the patient. He may wonder why you do not follow the instruction, and if ultimately the patient passes away, the family may blame you for causing further suffering. You say here there will be a arrangement which will be the subject of consultation in 2019, and the FSD has an open mind. When will the consultation period start, and when will it end? You only mentioned 2019. Mr. Lee, Darrell Lee, Director of Fire Services. We are about to conduct the study, and we work with relevant organizations. I may have to inform the member of the exact days later. According to the law, an injured person or patient must be provided with first aid before the arrival at the hospital. We know that the system of advanced medical instruction we will tie in. Yeah, that's why I asked this question. So I hope after public consultation, there may be a need to amend the law. I hope the FSD and the Security Bureau will bear this in mind. Next, SB198, safety standards at the airport. I'm concerned about air freight cargo, which will be subject to 100% X-ray scan. I agree with the reply that we need to adopt a multi-pronged approach. But maybe my question was not put very not, accurately. I asked whether the government would waive some fees, royalties, etc., at the airport. And the answer was they are not collected by the government. Yes, maybe I didn't ask the right question. The levies or royalties will be collected by the AA. If 100% X-ray scan is required in the future, should something be done to help the industry to tie over? Would you talk to the AA so that such fees, etc., can be waived?
Secretary, thank you. Of course, we welcome any views and then we will further consider them. I think Mr. Tam is aware of the ICAO's requirements, the International Civil Aviation Organization. And we will communicate with them to find out the rationale behind such requirements. Next, Mr. Holden Chow, 4 minutes. Thank you. I would like to follow up on 107. It's asked by Mr. Gary Chan. I would like to follow up on the reply. This is about sexual abuse against children or physical abuse against children. According to the reply, that for the past 3 years, the total number of cases of child abuse are about 800 cases. We understand from press report that the police have been doing a lot to combat these cases. But 800 cases is still too high. We don't know about the prosecution number of prosecution because it's not in the reply. People are scared that there will be some cases not reported. But are there cases that are not reported? If you can give us the number of prosecution or number of convictions, then it would better reflect the actual situation. Would you have records like this? I'll defer to the Commissioner, Mr. Low. I thank member for the question. You're right, in the past 2 years, the number of cases stand at 800 or so, and there was an increase in 2018. But if you look at it for the past 5 years, from 2013, it dropped from 1,290 cases to 893 in 2018, a drop by 31%, that is 405 cases. Children can't protect themselves, that's why we attach a lot of importance to these cases. We have a child abuse investigation team in different formations, and these are dedicated teams. We have also enhanced training of officers to deal with child abuse cases. We will also timely refer these cases to social welfare organizations and, if necessary, apply for a protection order. What's most important is public publicity and education. In 2018, we have organized 11 talks covering 1,700 teachers of primary, secondary, and kindergarten schools and kindergarten, as well as social workers. But we don't have a number of prosecution. We will find the information to give to you. Anything to add, Mr. Chow? Yes. I hope that you will be able to give us the prosecution number. Well, The number has dropped from 1,200 to 800 over a period of 5 years. Yes, the initiatives have been effective. I agree with the commissioner. Public education should continue. Next, Mr. Ma Fong Kwok, 4 minutes. I would like to follow up on 200 in relation to government flying service. In the reply, you said that you have with mainland and overseas organizations conducted exchanges. So I'd like to ask about the three exchange activities. With what departments and what were they about? I understand that there will be some helicopters being retired. There is a Puma, Super Puma. It was involved in a rescue operation in Sichuan. Will you select helicopters as well as some fixed-wing aircraft to put in the Kai Tak Park? I will defer to Captain Chen of the Government Flying Service. That was one exchange with the Transportation Department of the mainland. And there is another one with Public Security of the mainland. I stand to be corrected. For Super Puma helicopter that will be retired, we don't have any plans to use them as public exhibition. It's like the fixed-wing aircraft we have done. But we will continue to keep in view whether we will find similar aircraft like the fixed-wing aircraft to enhance understanding by the public. Well, you said that there were exchanges with the mainland departments. Can you tell us more about the content? What kind of exchange is it? Was it? Well, it's mainly training of crew, professional training. Mr. Ma, any joint operations drills? In the past year, as I recall, there was none, but I would double check and then give you a written reply. Next, Mr. Wu Jiwai, 4 minutes. Thank you. I have two questions to ask. First is number 27. One of the objectives of the Security Bureau is to continue to exchange views with CPG on one-way permit and two-way permit. But after 2011, it seems that there was little views exchanged. Well, you haven't given us a further answer. That means that after 2011, there was no views forwarded to the CPG on the operation of one-way permit and two-way permit. And you have not exchanged views on the problems encountered. If there are exchanges, can you tell us what they are so that we'll know if the Security Bureau knows about problems and the concerns of Hong Kong people on one-way permit and two-way permit? The second part is quarters. I have received a lot of inquiries from discipline service officers. There is a housing shortage. It's not easy for them to be allocated housing so that they can vacate the staff quarters. A lot of people can't find alternative accommodation. That's why they have to stay in the staff quarters, and they may have to pay market rates or pay punitive rates. So what it is all about? That they are required to vacate, but they are not allocated alternative housing. Apart from competing for housing resources for allocation, are there any way, other ways? Say, for example, sale of home ownership scheme units. Will you talk to them to see if priority can be accorded to them? If they can get housing, then they can vacate the quarters. Thank you. Two questions. Secretary, one about one-way permit, the other about disciplined service, married quarters. In relation to operations and relevant matters, we have been communicating with mainland authorities. And in the process, we learned that mainland authorities have put in place measures in response to our views. Say, for example, overage children. Yes, you have already answered me, but what about after 2011? Because it's been 8 years. I was answering you. After 2011, we have communicated with mainland authorities over 8 phases. There are still measures being implemented in relation to overage children, and the other thing is single mothers. We have received 160 requests for assistance, and we have already dealt with 100 of them. And there are other cases that make use of other ways, not one-way permit, to enable them to come to Hong Kong to visit relatives. About housing and quarters, I thank Mr. Wu for expressing concern about that. But this is not just about disciplined service, it's about using housing to help civil servants. Well, I thank you for making the suggestion that we can talk to the housing authority. We'll see what we can do with them. Dr. Fernando Zheng, 4 minutes. I'd like to ask about 107 child abuse cases of the child abuse cases. How many of them have been followed up by social workers? The police said that they don't have the information. I find it strange, because just now the commissioner said that in relation to these cases, you work closely with the social welfare department. I believe that these cases will be referred to social workers. How come you don't have a record? Well, under the social welfare regime, there will be a cross-discipline meeting with the participation of the police. I think it's something is missing if the police hasn't kept a record. And the number never tallies. In 2018, the police said that there are 893 cases, but according to the Social Welfare Department, 1,064 cases. Under the breakdown, sexual abuse against children, according to the police, 456, according to the Social Welfare Department, 297 cases. It seems that for the Social Welfare Department, they have a higher number of total number of cases, but a lower number in relation to sexual abuse. How do you deal with this difference? If according to you, there are 400 or so sexual abuse against children, there is no reason for you not to refer these cases to the social welfare department. Can you explain about the stark difference, Mr. Low? We we keep statistics and records for enforcement and police operations. Well, there is no such category in our computer system. That's why we don't keep the figure, and I can't answer you. In relation to the differences, on other areas, say for example, domestic violence, there is a difference. Some victims only report to the police, but did not go to the social welfare department, and vice versa. For the police, we use case as the unit in our statistics. When there is one report, it is one case. As far as I know, for the social welfare department, they use the person requiring assistance as the basis. Maybe for this reason, there is a difference in the number of cases between social welfare department and the police.
In that case, the figures kept by the SWD should be lower, because you have you are referring to the number of times you have received the complaints. You say you don't have this box in your system. So I'm worried that referral might not happen. You don't make sure that the referral to the SWD would happen when you receive a complaint. We want to safeguard the best interest of children. So we want to make sure that the case would be looked into by social workers. It's the social work perspective. It's not just it's not about law enforcement. Can you make sure that under your system, a child abuse case will be referred to social workers all the time? I will look into that. Mr. Alok Him, 4 minutes. I may not need all 4 minutes. I just want to offer some comments, but welcome responses. SB 178. This is how I see it. It's my observation. I hope the commissioners and directors won't mind this. There's a discrepancy of the terms and conditions of employment of different discipline services. You have a commission to look into the differences, including the rankings and the pay and conditions of service. I just want to make sure that the things would be aligned among different discipline services. Commissioner of Police has told us that you will be able to make up or reduce a shortfall, so it will be 80%. But for the FSD, it's just 70-odd% this year. And the CSD has been talking about wastage and turnover of their staff because of the working environment and terms and conditions of employment. That's why I want to raise this question. I'm not saying that a particular service should be a better pay or now the police have achieved an 80% target of quarter provision. But you know that the waiting time for PRH is more than 5 years. So I would like to say this in response to the Commissioner of Police remarks. I've been an organizer of public protests and processions for some years. I think good communication is important. Well, you know that I don't think I'm regarded as a dangerous element. I have seen communication problems with the police that handles this. And since we have someone from the IPCC here as well, when we deal with public possessions, in the past, the practice was fairer. During the time of Mr. Chak Siu-tong, well, you try to meet everyone, but not now. So, Secretary, any response? Mr. Ngao has raised a number of questions which he had already put some time ago. We heard him. My colleagues would look at ways and means to respond to those views and suggestions. Last member to speak, Mr. Yik, Fengki Yik. Two questions. 166. And that is the so-called the cracking down of passenger unauthorized passenger service of vehicles. There were fewer than 100 cases, but we have more than we have tens of thousands of vehicles involved in such illegal operations. We know that the penalties will be increased under a proposal from the Transport and Housing Bureau. I hope the police will step up its efforts. I know recently something has been done. And it's been advertised that you have a Category 1 or Category driving license. You can lease a car. You don't need to own a car, and you can join their operation. And 117, question 117. Is the error on the part of the Transport and Housing Bureau so we don't have sufficient parking spaces? Commissioner, there was a protest of PLBs in Chengyi, and they refused to work because they've never taken into account when car parks are planned. And then there was another case. PLBs were given tickets extensively, and they tried to stage a strike. And then it was cancelled after mediation. I hope when these minibuses do not cause obstruction. I know there are people who frequently lodge complaints. You have to understand the minibuses have got nowhere to park. Commissioner, thank you, Mr. Yik, for your suggestions. You mentioned those unlicensed, unauthorized passengers service. Well, we would take follow-up action and if evidence is available. As for parking, we have been under pressure to step up enforcement against illegal parking. As I've said, illegal parking is caused by many factors. Of course, there are more. One of the factors is that the number of vehicles exceed the number of parking spaces. Since 2014, we have been issuing 1 million or so tickets. We issue 1 million or so tickets. In 2018, the number has increased to 2 million, but it seems that the problems have not been resolved. We need to work with other departments. We would do our best to balance the rights of the complainant and the complainee, and we'll be balanced in our approach in law enforcement. Where if people just indiscriminately park their vehicles, affecting
the public, you should toll the vehicle away. You shouldn't just give a ticket. Mr. Siu Ka Chun, 4 minutes. First of all, I would like to thank the Security Bureau and the staff of our departments. One, Hong Kong is one of the safest cities in the world. Many visitors are amazed in finding that out. So I have a question about visitors or problem with too many visitors. Tourism is very important for other industries in Hong Kong, such as retail and wholesale. During the occupation central movement and also the subsequent action taken by some to the cake the luggage of visitors, the sales volume dropped at one point by more than 20%, and because of the reduction in income, some of those practitioners were unable to pay their mortgage, and some were forced to change jobs and work in construction sites. So tourism is important for our economy. It's important that we have tourists coming to Hong Kong. Don't give anyone the wrong impression that we don't welcome the tourists. There was a public procession in the North District. I've been told by some of my constituents in the retail center that there was an immediate drop of 30% in business volume after that. And now we have seen a downward trend of the business volume by, say, some 10%. I know there's the concern of in certain districts about the numbers of visitors. We know the in To Kwa Wan and Kowloon City, there are people who use the facilities there to board the cruises and or vessels, sightseeing vessels. You should try to make arrangements so that the operation will be smooth and will not cause problems. Don't give people the impression that we don't welcome mainland visitors. We know that there are video cams on the body of police, some police officers. Many LegCo is supportive, and many people also support the introduction of this equipment. Because you have people who try to provoke the police officers, and the video recording will be useful if there's a prosecution in court. And there are the unscrupulous taxi drivers plying Lan Kwai Fong or the Peak. Can you catch more of them and impose heavy penalties on them? Commissioner, we have 2,260 body worn video cameras. We are going to buy more in the coming year. In the newest generation of communication device, on 1,000 of them, there will be the incorporation of video recording function. We hope that by 2021, every officer will be given one. So we buy one, then our communication devices will also be video recording ready. And as for the taxi operations, we would gather our intelligence and do more. The next meeting will be held at 3:30 p.m. That's the end of this session. Thank you.